Are we rolling? Buenos dias! Today I'd like to talk to you a little bit about BC Ridge guitars and why they have such a poor reputation in the guitar community these days. So I'll get right into it. I have quite a bit of ground to cover in this video. To start off on a nice and boring dull note, let's talk about Guitar Center for a little bit. What I'm about to say is not to say that the brand doesn't have like issues that are their own fault, but I'll circle back to that in just a bit. Guitar Center is a music store chain founded in the 1950s in Hollywood, and they've since essentially existed to be a guitar store monopoly and put smaller independent music stores out of business. For instance, in a video made by someone at Gary's Guitars, a small independent music store in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, someone explains that for a certain undisclosed electroharmonics pedal, the store charges $89. The store pays direct from electroharmonics for this pedal $53. Now, 3% of the revenue likely goes to some local bank because most people don't pay cash anymore these days. And some of the profit will inevitably go towards keeping the lights on, the heat on, paying the rent, you know, just keeping the guitar store going as a whole, obviously. So that, at the end, leaves the store with very little profit from that pedal as is. Allegedly, Guitar Center sells this same electroharmonics pedal for $69. That is $20 less. Their margin on EHX pedals is bupkis. Guitar Center is a chain of stores bought up by an investment firm and inflated with loans to become a market leader, which is why they owe companies like Godin, or owed companies like Godin money. Godin makes guitar hardware, you know, tuning pegs, bridges, stuff like that, because they likely just intend to stock the gear now and pay later, you know, and that is not ideal for a supplier. When looking at the vendors on BC Ridge's website, two stores clearly prevail, Guitar Center and Long & McQuaid, in Canada. The difference between those two being that Guitar Center, as I mentioned earlier, is famously owned by investment firm Bain Capital, while Long McQuaid is still 100% owned by the Long family. Translation, very unlikely to be a money laundering scheme. So, take a look, I'll show you. Alright, I've just opened BC Rich's website and gone to dealers, and I'm just going to read them to you in order, one by one. Guitar Center, Long McQuaid, miscellaneous. Starting off, Guitar Center Times Square, Guitar Center Union Square, Guitar Center Brooklyn, Guitar Center Paramus, The Music Zoo, Guitar Center Advantage Music, Alto Music, Guitar Center Boston, Carlino Guitars, Chuck Levin's Washington Music Center, Long McQuaid, 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 Long
McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid, Long McQuaid,
Yep, I think it's safe to say BC Ridge have firmly placed all of their eggs in the two industry-leading baskets. Sure, there's exceptions here and there, mostly the big guitar stores we've all seen like Instagram reels of, you know, Drum City, Guitarland, stuff like that. But mainly Guitar Center and a lot of Long McQuaid as well. Now, I don't know if this is how it actually went down, it's a hypothetical scenario, not accusing anyone of anything, but it's not unlikely that things went this way. Guitar Center now has leverage over BC Rich. You know, they pull all of the classic market leader moves, you know, I'll stock now, I'll pay for your stuff later. Again, very not ideal for the supplier, but they don't have much of a choice now, do they? So, understandably, Guitar Center starts off stocking the cheap stuff, and it sells quite well, actually. Edgy teenagers looking to be like their, I don't know, who played BC Ridge guitars back then, Slipknot, I guess, I don't really care, looking to be like their idols, they flock to that shit, so Guitar Center just keeps on stocking the low-end made-in-Indonesia crap. Don't believe me? When you read the name BC Ridge in the title of this video before clicking on it, what did your mind go to? The high-end exotic Mockingbirds and Warlocks with the abalone binding and the Fishman Fluence pickups? Or that? Something tells me it's that, because you've gone into a big guitar store and played that before, haven't you? You haven't played this, but you've played that. I mean, it's terrible that that's still the association, but for me it was as well, just for the longest time. But yeah, circling around to the problems that are actually the brand's fault. I've played a high-end BC Ridge guitar before. In fact, bringing it out a little early, I know. I have this thing, and it is amazing. It's beautiful, I love it. It's also, I did not know they would be this comfortable for neoclassical players. This thing is amazing. A little more about this later. Very glad I can finally have the guitar stand not empty. Guitars by BC Ridge have not always been like this. Back in the 90s, they had some huge problems with quality control that they haven't been able to clear their name of to this day, which is not fair because, again, their guitars are not like this anymore. But with the demographic they were clearly intended for back in those days, who really gives a shit how it played or sounded? It's just that these days, selling a vintage BC Ridge, that's not a flex anymore, that's you trying to get rid of garbage. Now, again, I mentioned that this guitar is amazing, and I stand by that. However, BC Ridge have never really been the best value-for-money brand. For instance, their cheap guitars, and I mean the really, really cheap, low-end, made-in-Indonesia guitars, are often, to this day, made of agathis, a wood so hated by guitar players, almost all guitar players, that you'd think it'd catch on and brands would try to make a change, but not BC Ridge. By all accounts, popular woods for guitars in that price range, you know, the really, really low-end stuff, are poplar and basswood. In fact, I'll show you something. The cheapest guitar I could find on Thomann, a 79 euro Harley Benton Strat copy, in candy apple red, if you can read that, basswood body. Done. I don't have to prove my point anymore. It was proven for me. If they're not using agathis for that thing, what's BC Ridge's excuse? Right? I'm sure you've seen the really low-end Kerry King signature Warlocks, you know, the ones in black with the really edgy, like, tribal flame design and red on the front. Yeah, those. Those are made of agathis. They don't have a tremolo, certainly an odd choice for a guitar with Kerry King's name on it, but I'm sure with a wood that soft, you can create a similar effect to a dive bomb by just bending the neck forwards. Why that wood? However, the situation with BC Rich's higher end guitars isn't much different. They are obviously much better instruments. However, I did not mention how much I paid for this guitar. I'll mention it now. 1,600 euro, which is roughly 1,800 US dollars, I think. That is too much. Something I also didn't mention, this is a Floyd Rose 1000. If you don't know what that is, a Floyd Rose 1000 is in between the Floyd Rose Special, you know, the really cheap ones, and the handcrafted German Floyd Roses, which we just refer to as the original Floyd Rose. Those are what you aspire to have in your guitar. You want an original Floyd Rose 1000, sure, fine, on some run-of-the-mill, like, mid-range guitar. Floyd Rose Special, get out of here. Those things, oh god, they are a fucking nightmare. But, yeah. 1,000. Now, I found two reviews on Thomann that I think perfectly illustrate what I'm trying to say, but at the same time prove to you that I'm not making this up. Other people have said this. They're both reviews for high-end BC Rich guitars. I'll tell you which in a second. Both of these were written in languages that aren't English, so they didn't. Nothing got lost in translation. The grammar just got mangled a little, especially on the second one. This first one is for a satin white BC Rich Iron Bird, if I remember correctly, like 1,700-1,800 euro, I think. The Floyd Rose creaks and scratches with every movement. The volume part moves and wobbles with every turn. The quality of the ebony fingerboard should be mentioned positively, la la la. He goes on to compliment the quality of the fingerboard and the sound of the pickups, which, yeah, Fishman Fluence Modern, perfect, fantastic pickups. And towards the end,
if I do a comparison in this price range from 1700 to 2000 euro with an ESP E2, which is basically perfectly processed and adjusted, I come to the result.
The BC Rich Iron Bird is simply too expensive for what it offers. And yeah, that's a perfect review. It is not a bad guitar, it is simply too expensive. If this thing was like 900, maybe 1,000 euro, absolutely perfect. Alright, the next review is for a BC Rich Warlock Extreme. It's a bit cheaper than this one. I assume the specs are near identical, though. This one was translated from Italian. The grammar is a fucking nightmare, but you'll get the quintessence of it.
Unfortunately, the construction is still dirty and some details are not well cared for. Some paint points near the binding and the cover of the bridge hole screwed wrong. On the volume knob is Dancer, I assume means loose, and very plastic. On the keyboard, fretboard I assume, there are some stains that suggest drops of paint, plus traces of polish paste in various places. Is everything bad then? No. Pleasant and round sound in passive mode and growling in active mode. Fast and accurate neck, finished to perfection, perfect and functional bridge mechanics.
Ultimately, a good promise not yet kept by BC Rich. A promise not kept. I couldn't have said it better myself. I tried to look for the words and I couldn't. That person did it. Absolutely perfect. It looks promising, it really does, and then you buy it and you hold it and you go, eh, I spent too much. They could very easily improve this by just changing the current price tag or specking it out to be a 1600 euro guitar, but it just currently isn't. If I may draw a comparison to one of my favorite guitars that I don't own, Michelangelo Badio's signature guitar with Sawtooth, or one of the signature models he has with Sawtooth, it's a 7-string single cut with Fishman Fluence Modern pickups and a German-made Floyd Rose. 800 euro. That is half the price. I rest my case entirely. That is exactly what I mean. I'm not saying make this 800 euro, 900, 1,000. It has a kill switch. That's kind of a high-end guitar feature. However, it's a flimsy little plastic kill switch, you know? Yeah, I don't know. Back in the 80s, all the big thrash metal bands played BC Rich guitars. You know, they were the cool new edgy thing. However, over time, everything loses its shock value and becomes just way oversaturated and a little boring. The Warlock is certainly a staple of the more extreme side of metal music, but none of the big players actually use it anymore. Kerry King used to play a lot of the Warlocks in the Flying V's. He had a couple signature models. He switched to Dean. Dave Mustaine used to play the BC Rich Bitch, then he switched to Dean, then to Gibson and Kramer more recently. I think Nagel from Behemoth played BC Rich Warlock back in the day. He has a baritone ESP signature now. They've all gravitated away from BC Rich guitars. For money, obviously, I know that's the reason, that's the motivation behind it. But still, BC Rich isn't that big of a deal anymore. But they could be, they could reinstate that, they just haven't reignited that flame. So, for now, this remains sort of a boring, oversaturated thing. In summary, BC Rich isn't bad. They certainly don't deserve that reputation that they still kind of have left over from the 90s. Absolutely not. But they need to make changes, and they need to make them quick. They definitely would profit from, you know, expanding, working on innovating within their low and mid-range guitars, and as far as these high-ends go, either spec them out to suit the current price tags, you know, what could they do? I mean, it has a kill switch, that's a high-end feature. But it could be a metal kill switch, not this flimsy plastic thing. It could have a tone knob, maybe. I don't know. I mean, am I the only person who uses the tone knob? I don't think so. It has the push-pull active-passive switch for the Fishmans. If it had a tone knob, it could have a push-pull coil split as well. They have that feature. Use it. Why wouldn't you use it? Why would you not take advantage of the features that your hardware has given? And most importantly, the bridge. I'd rather have a high-end Kayla in there than a low-end Floyd Rose like this. Let me go get something. This is my 2003 Made in Mexico Splattercaster. Now, on Reverb, these go for like, on average, 800-900 euro these days. They made like 1200 of these, I think, 20 years ago. They've become a bit rare. This is my second favorite guitar, absolutely. I abuse this thing. I don't know if you can see the wear marks in this lighting. It has been played a whole lot over the couple of years that I've owned it. And this thing wishes it felt this good. Absolutely. The neck is smooth and all of that. It's the hardware that's just not good to use. I don't know. This is a poor position for the kill switch as well, if the whammy bar is in the way. Everything about it screams mid-range and not almost too grand. So, those were all essentially the reasons why I'm returning this guitar. My heart aches because I have to return it. I don't have to. I feel obligated to return it because it's a waste of 600 of my euro. Let's say that. I would gladly buy this or keep this if it was 900, maybe 1,000. If I was gifted this guitar, I would fucking freak out. Best gift of my life. But having paid so much money for this thing, it is not worth it and it is going back. However, tell you what I will do. I will keep an eye out on the used market, on sales and stuff like that. If I can get a version of this for, like, between 900 and 1100 euro, it will be mine in an instant, right? Because I love this thing, but not for that much money. So, thank you so much for watching. I hope this was somewhat worthwhile, even especially if you're considering buying a BC Rich. I don't know, subscribe somewhere over there if you feel like it. Assuming you're not watching this within the first 3-4 days of it being released, there will be at least one other video on this channel, so somewhere over here as well. Yeah, I'll see you in the next one.